Hello everyone, my name is Ben. I'm going to be talking about the Aries CLI, and I hope there's something in here for everyone. So let's start with installing. So for people who haven't used the CLI before, you can install it via pip, which is a Python tool. If you have Python on your machine, that's all you need to do. If you don't have Python, there is also an MSI installer or a bundled installer, and then you can use the version number to see if everything you have is up to date. It's built on top of Boto 3 or Boto Core, which is the Python SDK. So a lot of the things that I will show you are also available if you use Python, if you use Boto. Once you have it installed, you have to configure it. There are some files that are on the .aries folder in your home directory. The most important one is the config file, where you can say, if you do aries configure, that's also the file that gets written there. You can put things there like the default output, the default region to use, or you can go a step further. You can actually go say, instead of only having default profile, I'm going to use different profiles, for example, for different aries accounts or for different writes in one aries account. And you can go even further than that. So for example, our source profile here uses our long-lived access key and secret key that we store in our credential file. We can use that to get temporary credentials with an IAM role in another account or the same account. So the CLI will automatically see that we're using long-lived credentials, use those to get temporary credentials in another account. If needed, ask for your MFA serial. It will cache that on disk, so you don't have to put your MFA code in every time. And you can go even farther than that. You can actually change those roles. So I'm assuming a lot of you are already using this kind of config. You can actually go from that central account or that second account to another account. So if you're a real complex environment with a lot of accounts with a lot of users and roles, you can define it all in your configuration file, share it with your colleagues, and they can just say AWS Mimim profile account 2, and the CLI will do everything by default automatically. Use your access keys, assume one role, ask for MFA credentials, assume another role, and you just get the temporary credentials when you do the commands. And if you're not using a user, but if you're writing a script, you can also get those first credentials, that source profile, from the environment or from the EC2 metadata. So you can use the same configuration of kind of configuration on an EC2 instance or inside of an ECS container or any place where you can set the environment variables to other AWS credentials. And once you have everything configured, you can start actually using it. One of the nice things is that you can also, if something goes wrong, you can actually start debugging it. There's a debug flag where you get a lot of output about the arguments that you added there, the request was done. So you can really see what's happening there. There's one big downside with the debug, and that's how it actually looks. So you get a lot of output for everything that's happening in Python. Luckily, there's a better way to do it, and that's the history. That's something you have to enable beforehand. So you configure that either in the configuration file, or you say aries configure set CLI history enabled. And then you can do a list of the history. You can see all the commands that were issued previously. And you can show every command in more detail. If you add an ID, you get that command. If you leave off the ID, you get the latest command. And then you can see the whole flow that happens there. So the first step is that you actually enter something on the command line. So this is what the CLI tool actually saw as input. So it saw that we're using IAM and we're going to do list users. That gets converted into an API call. So we can see that we're going to use the IAM service, and again, list users. The CLI will actually transform that, or will use that API call to do an HTTP request. You can also see that, so you can see the full request that was sent. And then we go back the other way around, so we get a response that you can see everything that is in there. You can see the XML there, and that response then gets transformed into actually the parsed response that you actually get back from the CLI. And then at the end, it shows you that it exited and when it exited and what the return code was. So that's a far more easier way to actually look at what's happening there. And sometimes you really need that, but because now that we know how to debug it, we can talk about common problems. One of the problems that you might have run into is that you try to put a value somewhere, and that value is in a URL, and suddenly you get all kinds of errors about validation or length or things like that. And that's because the CLI by default will resolve every URL that it sees and use the content or the body of that web page as a value to put there instead of the actual value that you wrote down on the comment line. So for example, if you try to put google.com into the parameter store, you will get a long error because it will try to put the whole homepage of Google in the parameter store instead of just that key. Luckily, you can disable that. So I do that for every time I set up a CLI. I set the CLI follow URL parameter to false, and then it will actually do what you expect. Other things that you might run into is if you try to put things onto S3, and that you notice that it goes quite slowly, or at least not as fast as you would expect, because S3 is really fast. And that's because, by default, the CLI will only use, I think, 5 or maybe 20 concurrent threads to put things on S3. That means that if you're putting a lot of small files, it will not exhaust your CPU, not exhaust your bandwidth, so you will just have a lot of resources there that are not used. If you actually want to use those resources, you can increase the maximum concurrent requests, and then it will actually possibly exhaust your network, and that's the moment that you know that now we're going as fast as we can. On the other end, if you want to go slower, for example, if there's something else running on your machine while you're doing that sync, then you can limit the bandwidth, and that's here. You can say, okay, now we maybe want only 50 megabytes per second for the CLI, so we're sure that there's still bandwidth enough and available for everything else that you want to do. Some other nice things that you can do in the CLI, this is one that I use pretty frequently. One of my favorite commands is scs get caller identity, because that shows me which address account I'm using, which user I'm using there. And that's really easy to debug, really useful if you want to debug. But it's a lot of things to type. It's easy to make a typo there. So you can create aliases. There's a GitHub repo for that in AWS Labs that shows how to use them and has some examples there. But you can use it, for example, to say, okay, now I want to just type alias who am I, and you get exactly the same thing as if you would have typed alias STS get caller identity. More aliases that you can do or shortcuts that you can take is the query function. I use a lot, if you're experimenting with the CLI, you get a JSON back and you're trying to parse values out of that. There are some external tools to use for that, for example, GQ, which can parse JSON responses into something that's actually usable and get the data out of there. If you've developed that most of the time locally on your laptop, then you want to run that on a server. GQ is not installed, things go wrong there. For that, it's really easy to move those queries inside of the AWS CLI. So you already have the AWS CLI there, and then you can actually just get the information directly from that. If you add the text output, then it will also strip the quotes and the commas and things like that, so you can use it in the next step of your script. And there's more, but I don't have time for that because it's lunch. You can install bash completion or shell completion for a lot of shells, which makes it a lot faster to type all those things. One of my favorite ones is also the wait functions. So just like with the SDK, you can have the CLI wait for things to finish inside of your account, and then the CLI will do the looping, will do the waiting, will do the backoffs without having you to write all that logic yourself. And there are some third-party tools that are really useful. CFNLint is a tool to validate cloud formation templates, which saves you a lot of time if you're writing a lot of that. The AWS Encryption CLI helps with working with KMS and domain encryption. That also has some SDKs, which just released the JavaScript one, was released today. AWS Shell gives you better auto-completion if you do a lot of, again, if you don't like to type a lot, that really helps. And AWS Vault helps if you're using a lot of profiles, a lot of credentials, a lot of accounts where you have to assume different roles. It is a little bit better than the built-in CLI and can, for example, use your AWS CLI config to start the browser which you logged in that profile. So that's really useful. And now one last thing that I have to show you is that there's a new version coming. They're working on version 2, which will solve some of those problems, like the URL follow parameter. They started on it before reInvent last year. They haven't released it yet, but they started again a few, like 2 or 3 weeks ago to do some things on that. So I'm not sure when they will release it, but I feel like it's still coming. So maybe nice to check out and to try that out and see what everything is, what all the new things that are in there. And then I just have to say who I am before I send you out for lunch. My name is Ben. I work for Clouder. We're a Belgian company, but we also do business in the UK. You can find me on Twitter. You can find me here if you have any questions, or you can send me an email, and I will try my best to reply. Thank you.